Graduands, guests and colleagues, my name is Edward Joyner and I'm delighted to welcome you to graduation. I have a few announcements to make before we begin so that you can relax and enjoy the ceremony. Graduands, an easy job to start with, please check that your seat number matches the number on your ticket because you will be called to the stage in this order. If you discover that these do not match, our team of stewards can help you locate the correct seat. At the appropriate time, you will be invited by the stewards to stand and make your way to the foot of the stairs, ready to head up the stairs and across the stage. All very straightforward. There are two key things which make for a seamless ceremony. Firstly, as soon as the person ahead of you begins to cross the stage, please make sure you make your way up the stairs. Please don't wait until they have passed across the stage before you reach the top of the stairs. Secondly, don't let excitement and pride overwhelm you so much that you forget to pick up your degree parchment after you have crossed the stage. If you do, don't worry, you will still have graduated. But don't try to go back because you'll collide with someone coming the other way. Instead, please visit the graduation information desk in the Spring Lane building 30 minutes after the ceremony to collect your parchment. At the end of the ceremony, graduates are asked to process out of the hall directed by the stewards. Family and friends, the stewards will show you the exits once the graduates have left the hall. If the fire alarm should sound at any point, please remain in your seats. Instructions will be given and we will escort you to the nearest exit. As graduates, you will join an international community of over 130,000 York alumni in 183 countries. The York Alumni Association organises many events, networks and services designed to help you make connections with other alumni across the world and boost your career prospects. Please visit the Alumni Association stand and photo booth in Spring Lane Building, where you can pick up your graduation gift to welcome you to the Alumni Association. As you get your first job or take up further study or training, please remember to keep us in touch with what you're doing. Understanding the career paths you take will help us provide the right support for current students and make sure we offer graduates like you the relevant information and opportunities you need. Finally, please turn off your mobile phones. Will you please stand?
Good afternoon and welcome to the University. I have great pleasure in declaring the congregation open for the conferment of awards. Please take a seat. So, good afternoon again, and welcome to this very exciting day, which is a special milestone in your lives. This is also a wonderful time of year for everyone who works in the university. It's really inspiring and great to see so many happy and proud people here today. I want to offer you my warmest and most sincere congratulations. Gaining your degree from a world-class university like York is a tremendous achievement, and it shows just how much you have devoted your studies, your best efforts to your studies. The university is enormously proud of you, as are your families and partners and friends, and indeed everyone else who has supported you through your time here. When you made the decision to come to university, you made a choice that's likely to have a lasting effect on the rest of your life. As I'm sure you know, there are many reasons why people decide to go to university. Perhaps you came to York because you wanted to prepare for a career in your chosen field, or to improve your employment prospects. Perhaps you came because you were passionate about your subject, or perhaps you came because you simply wanted to be independent and leave home. Whatever the reasons, we hope you achieve your personal ambitions. In recent years, the public discourse around higher education has revolved around universities as drivers of economic growth and the role of higher education in delivering productive workforces. Whereas such constructs are undoubtedly important, we shouldn't lose sight of the much wider relevance of higher education for society. Education is a common good that benefits us all in ways that may be difficult to measure, but are certainly no less important. Education enables societies to work together, to build together, and to live peacefully together. Education protects us from extremism, intolerance, and prejudice. Fundamentally, education makes us better people. And I hope that you use your newfound skills to the benefit of people and societies worldwide. Now, I hope you've enjoyed your time at the university, which I'm sure wasn't completely spent on hard work and intellectual contemplation. I've seen and heard you having a wonderful time in your colleges and indeed in the city. I am, of course, also aware of what goes on through social media. Instagram, unfortunately, holds few secrets. And you know what all this says about you? Well, it shows that you are, on the whole, a lively, sociable, caring group of people with a great zest for life. And so it should be. Being at university is about much more than study and work. During your time with us, you will have met people who will remain friends for the rest of your life. You will have joined student societies or explored new interests. You will have experienced life in a community that is diverse and truly international. And I think that you'll find that these experiences have been just as valuable as any formal learning in shaping who you are and what you can become. Since the university was founded in 1963, we have inspired over 130,000 people to cross both this platform and also continents and embrace almost every imaginable job and profession. Now it's your turn to go out and explore new horizons. As graduates, you'll be part of our worldwide community of alumni with members from 183 countries in the world. Our global A to Z directory ranges from Afghanistan to Zimbabwe. And I hope that you'll be able to join us at events across the world and support many of our important activities. Whether joining a professional network or indeed volunteering time as an online mentor, there's plenty for everyone to do. We are, at our core, a community, and a community that still absolutely adheres to our founding principles of excellence, equality, and opportunity for all. One key element of our work is philanthropy, where we come together to support areas such as scholarships, which open the doors to education for students who've overcome tremendous difficulty to be here. And that's why a key theme of the York Unlimited philanthropy campaign is raising money to enable every student to shine, so that anyone who can benefit from a York education has the opportunity to do so. I know that many of you have already raised funds to support the next generation of students. You have played a vital role in ensuring that your successors will benefit from scholarship provision. So a big thank you. It's a tradition that speeches at graduation ceremonies close by offering much well-intended advice to inspire graduates. Actually, I don't think you particularly need my advice, but there are some things that probably matter more than anything else. First, try and be kind and compassionate to other people, because kindness and compassion underpin civil society. Second, never forget that the world is a very interesting place. Never stop questioning and trying to understand it better. Third, make sure you enjoy whatever you do, but have the courage to change direction if you don't. And finally, be lucky, but do remember that Louis Pasteur said that chance favours only the prepared mind. So, for now, I wish you all well. Make us proud, and above all, always strive to be the best that you can be. And being York graduates, I'm sure you'll have a great time along the way. So, many congratulations, and good luck for your future. Thank you very much.
Vice-Chancellor, I have the honour to present the following candidates. For the degree of Doctor of Philosophy in History for research in citizenship and belonging in 17th century London, Claire Benson. For research in China's educational modernisation, Ding Yi Yun. For research in archives, communities and values, Victoria Hoyle. For research in American polities, David Jones. For research in political culture and policy making in Hong Kong, Florence Mock. And for the degree of Master of Arts in Early Modern History, Chloe Howard. For the degree of Master of Arts in Renaissance and Early Modern Studies, Emily Wood. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in History and French, Alistair Bryan. Elliot Collins, Hannah James, Misha McCaskill, Lily Pryor, and for the degree of Bachelor of Arts in History, Lily Abel. Esther Alderson, Anika Ali, George Ankers, Harriet Atherton, Chloe Baker, Georgina Barker, Isabel Barker, Chloe Beasley Cottle, Thomas Beeples, Miranda Bell Pearson, Phoebe Bendel, Luke Binstead, William Blackett, George Blackman, Thomas Blount, Niels Boonder, Lucy Alexandra Booth, Natalie Bowers, Kimberly Bowker, Elizabeth May Box, Samuel Bridgewater, Courtney Brotherson, Danielle Buckley, Lucy Burgess, Emily Buzzer, Emily Canlis, Emma Carroll, Michaela Chervonova, Miranda Chaloner, Shun Yen Chan, Jasper Cheercroft, Ellie Cloughton, Olivia Clements, Lauren Clements, Megan Coates, Joseph Cole, Josephine Collett, Josh Collier, Hannah Collier, Neil Collingwood, Niall Collingwood, William Conway, Eleanor Cripps, Eleanor Croft, Matteo Daghini, Oliver Davies, Sydney Dawson, Megan Day, Jan de Boer, Tom Dill Russell, Catherine Deutsch, Ann Dumbell, Sophie Dunn, Matthew Edwards, Ewan Victor Elsden, Emma Farley, Kieran Fay, Samuel Flint, Lewis Ford, Dexter Ford, Tilly Foster, Harry Freeman, Robert Gadsby, Henry Gard, Lucy Gibson, Hanan Golabi, Alexander Golek, Liam Greenacre, Katie Greenaway, Zoe Gunter, William Hadley, Charlotte Hulse, Benjamin Harding, Gabriel Hargreaves, Emma Harris, Louisa Hart, Keely Hayes Davies, Christian Haywood, Millie Heathcock, Emily Hembro, Sammy Hepper, Antonia Hervioy, Darcy Hill, James Hoyle, Nicholas Hook, Hannah Hosking, Findlay Hulse, Irini Iacovudu, Willow Ingleton, Jiwon Jiong, Oliver Jones, Adam Young, Charlotte Kale, Zara Keane, Jennifer Kelsey, Isabel Kennedy, Paul Kerr, Alice Kidd, Rihanna Megan King, Alice Kinghorn, Catherine Kirkham Sandy, William Knights, Alina Cook, Will Laidlaw, Helen Leatham, Dominique Lemonius, Grace Leonard, Elizabeth Lester, Isabel Lewis, Marcus Love, Thomas Luck, Una MacDonald, Joshua McCarroll, Tanisha MacLeod, Toby Maitland-Titterton, Olivia Mallett, Kerry Mannion, Holly Manser, Sarah McConnell, Phoebe Muckleduff, George McAvoy, Michael McKelvery, Morven McCrory, Jordan McWilliam, Catherine Metcalf, Olivia Mills, Jacob Malloy, Matthew Malloy, Richard Monks, Ben Moody, Isabel Moore, Eleanor Mottershaw.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ensemble E Anonimi will perform Here Comes the Sun by the Beatles and Run to You by Pentatonix.
as you were standing there, tried it was true, as your glance met my stare, but your heart drifted off like the land split by sea. I tried to go to follow, to kneel down at your feet. I'll run, I'll run, I'll run, run to you. I'll run.
Vice-Chancellor, I have the honour to present the following candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Arts in History. Ben Moyers. Bethan Mulcahy. Leo Niebuhr. Kate Noblett. Russell O'Brien. Afra O'Brien. Elliot Olden. Maggie O'Neill. Abigail O'Reilly. Georgia Owen. Cyrus Pantaki. Ellen Payne. Pioli Pereira. Anna Petrasso. Marcus Phillips. Dylan Reed. Dylan Redmond. Benjamin Rencher. Charlotte Rule. Abigail Richardson. Rebecca Ritchie. Sebastian Romanuk. Amelie Rothwell. David Rowley. James Sampson. Franz Schappendonk. Richard Schlag. Andrew Schofield. Kate Seymour. Rianne Shaw. Isha Sharma. Isabella Shaw. Emily Shipley. Oliver Short. Francesca Sika. Alexander Smart. Daniel Smith. Eloise Spooner. Sasha Spyrou. Saskia Starrett. Georgina Mary Stein Hemmings. Heather Swain. Olivia Taylor. James Taylor. Annie Thurlow. James Tickner. Ben Tilly Castle. Alexander Timotheou. Christopher Todd. Sam Tomkinson. Hope Twardo Cleb. Alice Van Cliff. Zoe Vine. India Walden. Jack Walker, John Watson Brown, Emily Worley, Kieran Wilkes, Anna Wilberg, Mary Willis, Samantha Wilson, James Woodman, Katrina Wooldridge, Charles Wright, Hannah Wright, Teresa Wright, Ella York. And for the degree of Bachelor of Arts in History with a year abroad, Victor Amara. Laura Aspinwall. James Bonomi. Rosie Boyd. Tim Drew. Samuel Gillespie. Angus Hayes. Annie Hussein. Sarah Krajewski. Maximilian Lancaster. Robbie Locke. Christina Margaret Saxon. Jacob Siriwardena. Claudia Sivori. And for the degree of Bachelor of Arts in History and Economics, Benjamin Allen. Kira. Dowie Rees. William Rennie. Kitty Sapp. And for the degree of Bachelor of Arts in History and the History of Art, Eleanor Mulkeen Parker. Olivia Richardson Martin. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in History and Philosophy, Riona Barrett Nocieri. Hannah Furnival Jones. Alexander Howarth. Olivia Kell. Felix Lacumba. Ellen Lucas. Samuel McEwen. Abigail Rowley. Alisa Samuels. Raina Tuska-Gushi. Jonathan Vickers. Sean West. And for the degree of Bachelor of Arts in History and Politics, Samuel Barfoot. Isabella Battaglia. Jack Burgess. Sebastian Correa. Helena Hoi-Yin Cheng. Franklin Davies, Rhys Fleming, Victoria Gargan, Elliot Kidney, Martin Kirsch, Philippe Lefebvre, Annie Lewis, Cara Lord, Emily Markham, Jack Masterman, Max Milroy Mason, Kieran Graham Neil Daly, Felicity Palmer, Emma Peel, Lawrence Popel, Nicholas Rufo Mayner, Lucy Scoffin, Sophie Sentance, Nicholas Shutter, Joseph Silk, Ed Smith, Matthew Smith, Andrew Telford, Angus Thomas, Ryan Watt, Sophie Whittingham, and Doug Wilson.
It is my enormous pleasure to introduce Ann Dumbell, our student orator, who will speak on behalf of the class of 2019. Our student orators have been invited to speak in recognition of their hard work on behalf of the student community and commitment to their studies. Our speakers have both pursued the most enriching experience they could during their time at York, as well as giving back to their community. On behalf of the class of 2019, I give you Ann Dumbell.
So, you're going to be a teacher. If you're a history student and haven't heard this question at least once, then you can count yourself lucky. Of course, there's nothing wrong with teaching, and we wouldn't be where we are today without the teachers who've imparted their knowledge on us over the years. However, the constant assumptions that history offers only a limited set of career choices can be quite draining and, frankly, demoralising. I don't understand this attitude. Graduating with a history degree is difficult. It is certainly not something everybody is capable of, and we shouldn't be putting ourselves down. History graduates have to be able to think critically, to weigh up information, and make interesting and well-informed decisions. Furthermore, we have to have the confidence to present and debate these ideas. And this is more than just academics and just being able to write a decent essay. Over the past 3 years, every single person graduating today has proved that we can clearly and coherently express ourselves in a variety of ways to pretty much anyone. Second year group projects for undergraduates kind of prove this, or it at least gave us all an answer to the question, tell me about a time you've dealt with conflict. We've all demonstrated an incredible amount of self-discipline and time management skills, even if it didn't always feel like we were totally nailing it, especially at 9 a.m. on a Thursday morning. Whether you were part of 20 societies or none, spent all your time in the library, or still aren't quite sure what Burton looks like, we all did something right. The world needs people, especially in this tense political climate, who can make decisions based on thorough and creative thought, who can juggle complex and sometimes conflicting priorities, and above all, who can communicate effectively. As history graduates, our skills are valuable and they are sought after. University has taught me that I can overcome and do more than I ever really thought was possible. I'm still as in awe of the people I've met over my time here as I was 3 years ago, many of whom are in this room today. I didn't know what I was capable of, but now I have the confidence to go out into the world alongside all of you. I've been particularly lucky to be surrounded by wonderful friends. Special mentions must go to Mary, Joe, Katie, and Tom for keeping me vaguely sane over this degree. I'm also perpetually grateful to the societies that I've been involved with, particularly York Community Consulting, who have been a constant source of development and support. Finally, I'd really like to thank the wonderful teaching and support staff within the department, notably Sabine Clark and Sally Walters, who have been so supportive in so many ways, from personal level right up to my work as department rep this year. You have to trust in the people around you. They have no reason to lie to you about the many things you are capable of. It isn't always easy, but I found that letting other people believe in you is one of the most empowering things we can do. Success doesn't have a single definition. Whatever is happening next, I think we could all do with being a bit easier on ourselves and on our degree. Our ability to graduate from history, regardless of the grades or the time it took to get here, is an integral part of what makes each and every one of us, without exception, interesting and valuable parts of society. And so, as we prepare to leave this chapter of our lives behind, I would like to invite, or perhaps challenge you all, to join me in believing that. Thank you.
Acting Vice-Chancellor and President, graduating students, their families and friends, and my colleagues. Catherine Hall is quite simply one of the most creative and distinguished practitioners of historical writing, researching, and learning now active in the UK. Her reputation rests on a body of exciting, deeply researched, and deeply thought work on key aspects of UK and imperial history. That work has focused on individual lives, whether of 19th century Baptist missionaries, of Birmingham women in the interwar period, of slaveholders in the UK and Jamaica, or of public figures like the historian Macaulay and the campaigner for West Indian slave owners' interests, Edward Long. She gives such lives full meaning by placing them within accounts of society and politics, of colonialism and slavery, and of the dynamics of gender, race, and class. Catherine's contribution rests on her ability to link intimate aspects of past experience with global histories, and to explore connections between work, culture, and politics, between personal relationships and social structures, and between past, present, and future. Most historians would be delighted to influence any one area of their discipline, but Catherine has led three game-changing shifts in our thinking. Back in 1987, the book Family Fortunes, co-authored with Leonor Davidoff, deployed detailed research in an inspiring rethink of the interactions between class formation, relations between men and women, culture and politics in England between the 1780s and the 1830s. It challenged the established views of that period as a whole, further developed in Catherine's writing in the 1990s on gender, class, and ideas of nation. A second game-changing contribution came in her 2002 book, Civilizing Subjects, exploring what she calls the entangled histories of 19th century Jamaica and Birmingham to show how British identities at home can't be understood outside the frame of empire. Empire stories are not just about what the British did over there, trade, colonies, missionary work, but about how British lives here have been shaped by involvement in empire. That interactive approach underpins a third path-breaking initiative led by Catherine since 2009, Legacies of British Slave Ownership, researching the legacy of British trade in enslaved people and of the use of their labour within the UK. Her group has followed people, followed compensation money, and followed politics all over the UK across the 19th century, revealing the legacies of slavery, visible legacies of slavery, within British business, culture, and political life long before the arrival of the Windrush generation. These transformative contributions are the achievement not just of a gifted historian, but of a scholar with outstanding ability to work with colleagues and students. Her success with the teams on the two legacies projects matches her achievements on the founding editorial collective of the International Journal Gender and History, and as co-authors of works like Family Fortunes and later Defining the Victorian Nation. The other two authors of that book have told me personally how creative it was to work with Catherine on what became their path-breaking joint work on how gender, class, and empire interacted to shape the nation in the mid-19th century. This parallels my own experiences of working with her on gendered nationalism in the early 1990s and on the empire at home a decade later. It also parallels Catherine's exemplary support of research students, based on the willingness to listen to their work and ideas, as well as probe them rigorously, stretching students while building their confidence. One of her major legacies is a new generation of historians in the fields in which she works, enabled by her, now making their own contributions to our discipline. Professionally formed in a period when collective effort, rather than just individual achievement or competition, were valued as intellectual assets, Catherine's activities model the best in collegial and collaborative practice. Her commitment to family and to personal relations is also important for that practice and a source of depth and insight in her writing. We are delighted that Catherine's sister, whose daughter in fact graduated from York, is here today. Catherine has a gift for friendship and enjoyment, happily taking 10 minutes out of a deep discussion of histories of women and nationalism, admittedly beside an Italian swimming pool, to show me how to varnish my toenails. I make these points not just for human interest, important as that is, but to argue that Catherine's warmth and humanity are integral parts of her excellence. An academic's contribution is often assessed by listing research grants and publications. But in Catherine's case, there are other important measures too. Her contribution to public understanding of her research via websites, newspaper articles, lectures, and television programs, like her sharing of her work in venues from Jamaica to Australia, places her in the finest tradition of public intellectuals. Like other practitioners of black and gender history, she offers that work both for its scholarly value and for its relevance to our contemporary concerns with equality and inclusion and the public good. Acting Vice-Chancellor and President, for her transformative contributions to history, for her exemplary practice as a scholar and colleague, and for her upholding of the wider public good, I present to you Professor Catherine Hall for the degree of Doctor of this University, honoris causa.
Thank you so much. Acting Vice-Chancellor and President, families, guests, graduands, it is with great pleasure that I accept this honorary degree from the University of York, and I thank the university, the History Department, and especially Dr. De Groot for her kind commendation. Having grown up in Leeds, I have always had a love for Yorkshire, and York has been one of my favorite cities from childhood. Not just the wonderful Minster and the delights of the Georgian architecture, but also, I would have to confess, the pleasures of Betty's Tea Rooms and their speciality, Yorkshire curd tarts, which I strongly recommend to you if you've never tasted them. I have been fortunate in having had connections with both the English and History departments here for many years. One of my nieces greatly enjoyed her undergraduate degree here. I have enjoyed research and writing collaborations with some of your distinguished staff, examined theses here, and given lectures. I have greatly admired the pioneering work done in the department on race and slavery, gender, nation, and empire. New historiographical approaches have been supported and incorporated into teaching as well as research, making York a truly excellent department in which to work. Those of you who have successfully completed your studies and are now leaving the relative safety of the university, venturing out into the wide world at a time when your prospects may be unclear, I would like to say that a training in historical thinking is one of the best possible resources that you could have. Histories, as you will have learned, are always contested. What once were the established orthodoxies of Whig history, with its belief in the forward march of progress, no longer hold. The dramas and tragedies of the 20th century, two world wars, the Cold War, decolonization, the fall of the Berlin Wall, have given way to new terrors in the 21st century, 9/11, the Iraq War, and all that has followed. Now we face new nationalisms and populisms and the climate emergency that threatens us all. Progress, we have learned, cannot be taken for granted. We can go backwards as well as forwards. There are few simple truths, and history is always a matter for debate and interpretation. But this must always be in relation to the theoretical frameworks with which we work, the empirical evidence that we collect, the painstaking work to be done with sources of every kind, and the exercise of imagination. At a time when facts are little valued in some quarters, and people in public life lie with impunity, the capacities you have to think critically and evaluate arguments carefully are worth cherishing. They will stand you in good stead. I wish you all well for the future. Much hope rests with your generation for us all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now, we're almost finished. I need to confer awards on all those students who elected to receive their degrees in absentia. I'd like to congratulate Catherine. I'd like to congratulate all of you on your achievements and your graduation. Can I please ask our guests, not the graduates, to stand, please? So, ladies and gentlemen, now is our last opportunity today to congratulate our new graduates and wish them well for the future. It's an uncertain world, but armed with their qualifications and knowledge, I'm sure they'll fare greatly. Please. Okay, now if I can ask the graduates to stand. Excellent. So you can see you are truly appreciated, but at the same time, your journey here did rely on a number of individuals to support you. There's the staff at the university, both academic and support staff and the estate staff. There are families and friends who've supported you and nurtured you and occasionally given you some money. So now is your chance to say thank you to them, please. Excellent, thank you. So I now declare this congregation closed. Please remain standing.